So I've prepared a joke in case we have something like this and we need to take time to set up, but I'm not sure if you guys want to hear it. It's really lame. Okay? Okay. So a front-end developer walks into a bar but turns around and leaves because he doesn't like the table layout. I warned you, it's really lame. Anyone else have any jokes?
Can you repeat the joke?
Sorry?
I don't get it.
Sorry?
Can you repeat the joke?
A front-end developer walks into a bar but turns around and leaves because he doesn't like the table's layout. Come to Rails, girls, bring a girl and we'll explain it to you. How are you doing?
I'm doing okay, but it's not coming up.
Oh, it takes a little moment to search. I think that we're going to try not to switch computers too much today, if possible.
It's looking for HDMI.
Yeah, what it does is it cycles through like each one of the different channels. So it eventually, it's a little bit slow. Yeah.
Got more jokes, Cal?
I have.
So you need to have a girl to go to Rails Girls?
Winston? Do we need a girl to go to Rails Girls?
Ideally.
No, no, we're starting again. No.
It's preferred for you to bring a lady as well, but you know.
So it's girls or couples?
You can just bring your friend. Yeah. I mean, Rails Girls is really, you know, targeted at helping ladies get started in tech. But if you want to then we welcome you as well. Just that we do not want to, you know, go out with the pitch that anyone can come, such that, you know, there might be more men than women, and that might make the ladies feel intimidated. So we didn't want to go out there. So hope you guys.
Okay, next time I will prepare sysadmin jokes. Ladies and gentlemen, Sasha.
Thanks. So I'm going to talk about this project of mine. It's actually a lot of self-promotion here because I created this project and I wanted to get this a bit out. And that's the reason why I'm talking about this. I'm going to talk about how you can write a web application in 6 programming languages. The number itself actually switched. When I first writing the slides, it was 3, and then it sort of grew, and after a while it became 6. You probably become more as I talk about it. Excuse me. Quick question first here. Anyone here program in anything else other than Ruby?
Yes.
What applications are Ruby? So what are the other languages you use?
C++?
For web applications, sorry, I forgot to mention that. For web applications. PayPal people are not allowed to talk.
JavaScript.
Python.
Bash.
I need to spell with you later. So, There's this particular survey that actually did survey the number of programming languages around and the popularity. And there have been a few of these. This is quite recent. I think this is in 2014, I believe. We had Java at the top, and then we have a bunch of other programming languages. We also have C++, Ruby, Python, and so on. So all these are the popular programming languages, right? And a lot of people have been writing in all these different kinds of programming languages. I've been writing in like a number of them, like, but although I think the most recent one has been Ruby and also with Go. But really, there are so many programming languages out there. So what is really the main thing when you try to write a web application? What are the languages that you choose? What is the first thing that comes to your mind when you choose a programming language to write your web application? Ease of use? How fast you create it. Anything else?
Performance.
Community.
Right.
How familiar you are with it. Like for those who are more business oriented, it's like, how can I build a team that has these skills, right? how can I maintain it over a long run? So there are a lot of questions when it comes about. And of course, when you get a... No, but not really when you're in the right application, right? You know how much. But as you build a team to actually build applications and you start to gather people, then the first question that comes to mind, so what are we going to build this thing in? And then like this group here, everybody has a different opinion. Right? Maybe you have a couple of people who like Ruby is the way, another few say PHP is the way, and another few let's go for Node.js. And then soon that escalates into all out war, right? We'll start to compare. In fact, just now as I was talking to somebody, somebody was asking me that, so what's the best programming language to write? How do you compare this programming language to that programming language? And very often you can't really compare because it's so difficult to say which one is the best feature of that. As you actually use more and more programming languages, it becomes increasingly more difficult. So programming language wars and choosing a correct programming language has always been a problem. The other one is dependency war, dependency hell. How many of you actually develop an application that eventually that you need to maintain? So most people when they develop application, is the first thing in your mind is that I developed this so that 6 months later I can maintain it. Or is it I develop this, I throw to my client and then run away. Very often you need to, right? Even if you don't intend to originally, after a while you need to. And then 6 months later, guess what happens? Your libraries change. Right? Your gems need to be upgraded. Your jar files need to be changed. Right? Your version needs to be changed. Somebody came out with a new version, right? Just talking just now. Ruby 1.8, and now it's Ruby 2.2, and along the way, all the dot versions, right? So you have dependencies in the libraries, dependencies in the programming language, dependencies in the platform. So how are you going to deal with all of this? Of course, my answer is polyglot. It might not be answer, but I just want to introduce this to you. So what's the premise of polyglot is that you can build mobile application with any language. So you don't really need to fight anymore, right? So if you like PHP, go ahead and use PHP. If you like to use C, go ahead and use C. If you like to use Ruby, Go, Node, whatever it is, go ahead and use that. But of course, you already know that, right? Because you can already write your applications in Node, you can already write applications in PHP and stuff. So what's so special about it? In Polyglot, what I wanted to do is that you can write your web application in all of the languages at the same time. Right? So you have one single application that's written in multiple languages at the same time. You're not talking about writing in one application in one language and then moving it to another language, or maybe writing two separate applications and integrating them together. I'm talking about a single application written in multiple programming languages. How does this work? So, some terminology now. So what I have is what I call an acceptor. Acceptor takes in HTTP requests. And then the acceptor talks to a broker through 0MQ. 0MQ is a messaging queue protocol. And then of course the 0MQ would talk to something that, sorry, the broker would talk to something else, what I call a responder. The responder is the thing that would actually do most of your work. So this is actually your, if you like, your business logic. Here I write something in Ruby, but of course you don't really need to just write it in Ruby. You can write it in other languages as well. Right? So you can write responders in Go, you can write responders in Java, and they can all respond to the same broker. They all interact with the same broker, and goes back to the acceptor, which again returns the response to the calling browser or application that you call. Beyond that, you don't need to just have one single acceptor, you can also have multiple acceptors. So I have an acceptor and a broker, but you can switch to creating your own acceptor in a different programming language. Therefore, you could have a front end that's completely different. Let's see how this works. So acceptor. Acceptor basically takes in the HTTP request on a browser from the application. It would be a purely HTTP request, comes in, And this is already done, so I've done a default acceptor in Go. So that's done. A broker, what it does is it will take in all the requests that comes in, and then it will distribute it to the correct responder. Okay, this is also done. I've already done this as well. So what do you actually need to do? You need to do this. You only need to write responders. Like you basically, this is your application. See how a responder looks like. So this is a responder in Ruby. You have the first part here, which are setting up all the gems. So you guys are all Ruby, so you know what is this. First, you need to define a route ID and a unique responder identity. So basically, you need to define what is the route. Say here, I want to define a route that is underscore hello slash Ruby. Okay, and I set the identity of this particular responder. It needs to be a unique identity among all the responders. I create a random UUID. Next, I need to connect to the broker. And this is all just syntax that allows Ruby to connect to Ruby responder to connect to the broker. After that, you need to register a responder. You tell the responder, you tell the broker, say, hey, I exist. This is me, I'm the responder. After that, you're ready to go. You're ready to accept request to come in. You can do whatever you want with it. Here, of course, nothing, I'm not doing anything with it. I'm just receiving the request. But you can imagine that this guy can actually do a lot of stuff. He can process the request, do his other stuff. And then when you're done with it, you want to return the response. You just return it in a array of four elements. You have to return the route ID to tell the broker where this is supposed to go to. You return the status. This is the HTTP status, the headers, and then your content body, if there's any. If there's no content body, then you don't need to return anything. Okay? Then finally, you need to send the response back. Okay, this is all you need. So this is an application. So besides writing in multiple languages, which is kind of a novelty, right? Because sometimes I think, why would I want to even do that at all? Like, I can jolly well just write in one program. And sure enough, can actually write a polyglot application in just Ruby, for example, right? And then, so what difference does it make? Why wouldn't I want to deploy in NLP nicer, faster, better app servers, Ruby app servers? Well, there are a couple other reasons. So one thing is, it's distributed by default, right? So, as you look here, I have an acceptor. I could deploy an acceptor in one server, broker in another server, and then I can deploy the responders in multiple servers. I don't need to actually deploy in a single one. And as long as they are connected to the same network, they are reachable, then the responders will be able to interact with the broker. The second is that as you build the application, you don't need to build everything all at once. You can actually scale it up. And you can scale up dynamically. So what I mean here is this here, you have the same setup. Say you have the responders here, you can add in another acceptor to scale it up, right? As long as it connects to the broker, and you could add in more responders, and you can add in as many responders as you want. And you can imagine every responder do not actually need to be written in the same programming language. You can write it in different programming language. So what does it mean? It means that as you build your team, you get a new guy coming in, and you get a C expert. So go ahead and write C responder. Write dozens of C responders. Put it in another server. Does it serve the same, different route only? No, it can actually serve the same route, as long as it does the same thing. Right? Of course, there's still the probability of errors coming up if you serve the same route using different responders is high. But nonetheless, you can if you want to. Okay? But of course, all these are risks that, as a developer, you need to take. You can also evolve your web application. What I meant just now. Let's say you have this setup, and tomorrow, this particular set of responders, you want to switch them out. Right? The logic is you want to remove the logic, you want to do a different kind of logic. What you need to do is just shut down the responders, and then swap it with a different set of responders, okay, serving the same route. and then you can actually don't even need to shut down the application at all. You just swap them out and swap them in. So these are some of the advantages, and Polyglot is still evolving. It's not a fully completed project, and it still needs a lot of work. So I'm actually going out trying to sort of get feedback and get, say, you know, help as well. If you guys are interested, you can contribute. Well, everything is in GitHub. You can go to the GitHub repository, fork it out, clone it, and then after that, play around with it. If you want, you can add on additional languages, and you can also see what else you can do with it. There's still a lot of things that are missing here. I think you can do a lot more things with it. But let me just go very quickly to show you the actual code, because I've been just talking about slides here so far, right? So by the way, this is the site. I've written a sample app I call Polyglot that shows you how to, it's, you can see I actually started with three languages and then I actually evolved into more. And in this particular example, I have shown here. I have written a responder in Ruby. I've written another responder in Java. You can see the Java one is a bit big, but actually it's not because it's just Java, right? although, controversial, but actually it's big because the Ruby one was just responding with plain string. This one I actually need to connect to the database and return some. And I did one in Go. Go is a little bit big as well. So if you look at the one in Ruby, so what I did was I actually used Haml. Talk a little bit about this. So I actually use Haml, and I have Haml layouts as well. Right. So whatever you're familiar with, using Haml, you can do this. You're familiar with using ERB, you can do something else. If you're familiar with whatever it is that you want to use, right, you can just use this. For Java, it's just this guy, then I use the jar files. It's a bit small, I don't have that much usage. And Go, this is the Go template. So this is the Go code. But beyond that, I have this in other languages as well. I have, as of today, I have this in 6 different languages. I have done this in C. Okay, so this is the C code. Of course, I've done this in Ruby, which I showed you a bit just now. I've done this in Go. I've done this in Python. I've done this in Java. And I've done this in Node. So as long as the language actually supports 0MQ, which essentially is a communication protocol, you can add that language in. So I didn't actually do more, because I actually do a lot more, but that would require a little bit more time. But you get a picture, right? You can actually add as many languages as 0MQ can support. And 0MQ, I think they support 20 different languages. So they actually support Bash as well. If you really want to, I suppose you can write that. So that's the end of my presentation. Any questions?
So the responder, right, is it provided
by
a separate process?
Yes. So it runs on a separate process. I didn't actually talk about this. So basically it runs on a separate process. And it's scalable in the sense that today you can run, say I created it in C, right? Basically, it's a C program. I can run 10 copies of it on one server. And then, of course, you need to do the usual stuff to manage those 10 processes.
then if you think that you need more, because what happens is the broker will do round robin and basically allocate according to the different processes. If you need more, you just start up another 10, start up another 20, start up another 50. Like, as many as your server can take it. If your server cannot take it anymore, go to whichever hosting provider, you can start up another server and then run the other processes on it. So it's scalable in that sense. That's the same protocol that came up on Facebook, right?
Yeah, so it came up on Facebook in 2007, and they tried to solve the problem of it's an RPC kind of system that have different, it's also client server architecture, different programming languages.
So I've not actually looked into Trist. I know about it, but I've not looked into it. In reality, this is kind of novel. Some of you might look new, but actually, this approach, as I sort of tried to get responses and feedback from people, somebody told me that there was somebody who actually did something very similar to this called Mongrel 2. I'm not sure whether you've heard of it. You probably have heard of Mongrel, right? So Zed Shaw, he left the Mongrel project after some experts, and then after that, when you create Mongrel 2, right? And Mongrel 2 uses ZenMQ as well, uses ZeroMQ as well. So there are similarities. I've not really actually used Mongrel, but there are some similarities. But Trif, I've not tried. Yeah. Have you tried it?
I've not tried it, but I have heard of it, and I know it solves a similar problem, so I just wondered whether you have checked out the project, maybe like gotten similar ideas.
Oh, no. I did not check them out. Because I thought that Trif is a protocol. Therefore, I did not actually check it out. The truth is, the protocol, I thought it was a protocol like ZeroMQ. So I like ZeroMQ, so I'm using it.
Have you tried
Mongrel
2? Acceptor
to broker is true.
I mean,
the
data, so let's say we send it other than get request.
Oh, you can do post-request.
Multi-part.
You can do multi-part as well. So I have an example that actually sends up binary back. Yeah, it does multi-part. It does post, it does. It actually does get and post at this point in time. It actually doesn't do anything else, but I suppose it can actually do other stuff.
How is dynamic like the route can? If I want a dynamic URL? Let's say post slash one kind of
post slash anything.
Yeah. Right.
So you need to set the route ID. So as long as you're post slash something, then whatever. So you need to actually go to a particular URL, and then from there on, whatever you send as a part of the HTTP request will be read in, and you can pass it. You can do stuff with it. Dynamic URL, as in you're able to have slash whatever it is and slash whatever it is. That does not actually exist as of today. Okay. I think it can be added in, but I am personally not in favor of that because I'm more in favor of having fixed URLs and then the fragments itself in the data for get, or it will be in a post. So that's
somewhat query string.
Sorry?
Query string.
Query string, the fragment. That's my preference, but I think it can be done.
How do you make sure that broker is not a single point of failure?
Today it is a single point of failure. It's, of course, the project is not production quality, right? So it should somehow be able to load balance itself. You can probably have another broker and then do some heartbeat between the brokers. So there is a particular pattern in ZeroMQ that allows you to do that. I have not implemented that. If you are interested in it. Anybody actually done ZeroMQ here?
So what are the, I guess, go to the GitHub page, but I think they're useful next few big items that you have for this project to be done.
So I think one of it was raised up just now. Broker is today a single point of failure. And I think without having that, then I think a lot of these things what I talk about. So a lot of things about is like future looking, right? Because really the broker is the thing that's quite a few there. And if the broker goes down, then it goes down. The second thing is it needs a lot more testing. It needs a lot more rigorous testing. So I think that's the second one. And then fleshing out the rest of the HTTP methods is another one. But by far, it can be used as a simple applications already, except that it's definitely not the version ready. I saw somebody asking, does it make sense?
So what's the big advantage of using this over something like Nginx as a web browser and running all the applications separately?
Multiple web applications?
Yeah.
As in?
You run your Java process separately, you run your Ruby process, you've got an Nginx that's going to send particular routes to the Nginx process.
So, that is multiple applications, this is a single application.
But you still need different runtimes for different languages, right? Or you still need different processes for each of the different languages?
You see different processes, but it's a single application in the sense that if your front end, if you actually manage to maintain the session between, you can actually maintain the session through your backend processes. You can send in a cookie to be stored in the browser, for example, right? Then another kind of responder will actually take that and use that to the server. Nginx doing that, to be honest, I've not tried all the different other variants, right? So I thought this is a good way of doing this, and it allows me to be distributed. So that's why I've not actually tried the Nginx approach. Could maybe do that, I'm not really like comparing successfully.
VMQ is to pass all the shared.
Yeah, so the ZeroMQ is a protocol that allows different components to interact with each other.
Okay, guys, if you have more questions for Sasha, please come up and talk to him more after the rest of the talks, and we're going to move on to the next topic now. Please thank Sasha.